Okay, so we'll continue with the discussion on solution to system of linear equations. Yesterday we started off with a very simple system wherein we considered only two variables x and y. I told you there are umpteen ways of solving the system of equations when only two variables are present. The simplest would be to plot them on a graph, right, and the point of intersection will give you the solution. This could be extended to three dimensions, x, y, z. Anything beyond three dimensions, this graphical method will break down, will not work. Therefore, we have to take recourse to other techniques. Matrix inversion is a powerful technique where you put the system as Ax equal to b, right, and then take the determinant of A and rewrite this as x equal to A inverse of B, determine the inverse and then multiply it by the B and get the values. This can be used for any number of components, but beyond 100 variables, generally it is very, very painful. Matrix inversion is painful. So, in the subject of numerical analysis, people have developed several techniques to solve a system of linear equations. So, I told you some of the methods: Gaussian elimination, Gauss-Jordan, Cholesky decomposition, ELU decomposition, upper triangularization, lower triangularization, Cramer's rule, so and so forth. But the Gauss-Seidel method is a very powerful iterative technique which is frequently used by the thermal science people, basically because eventually one day or the other many of you will solve some CFD equations. So we solve the Navier-Stokes equation, the equation of energy, which basically you convert all these different partial differential equations into finite difference or finite volume equations. Once you have finite difference equation, the information at one point depends on the information in the surrounding points. This is what is called as an elliptic system. So when the information at one point is dependent on the information at the surrounding point, you connect all these through the physics and then you got a relationship, one variable in terms of the neighboring variable. Likewise, the neighboring variable is a function of which neighboring variables, and there will be overlap and so on. So we'll have a system of simultaneous equations which need to be solved at each time step, for example, or each iteration. So there the Gauss-Seidel method will be extremely powerful. Okay, people don't use matrix inversion and so on for if you have million nodes and so on. Gauss-Seidel method is extremely powerful. But before that, as I promised, we look at this ill-conditioned system. Yesterday we looked at this system 2x plus 3y equal to 12 and 1.9x plus 3y equal to 11.8. This system is ill-conditioned because the slopes are so close, so that it becomes very difficult for us to identify the correct point of intersection. So the determinant is also very small. When the determinant is very small, since you get 1 by d, it leads to divergence, it leads to difficulty. So we'll just plot this on Excel and see. Oh, where are the equations? So 12 minus 11.9. 11.86 is also very bad. You can hardly see anything. Okay, minus 1.98. Where are the plots? You want line plot? This is also okay. Yeah, we'll do that also. Okay. So you can see they're hardly indistinguishable. You cannot, using graphical method. Suppose you take a 0.7 mm lead pencil, then it's all over the place. You'll get the solution. So Deepak is not happy with this. So what do you want me to do? Okay. line.
Second.
Here. Here. You like that? Okay. Okay. Now you can see that latecomers, you are still trying to look at how the system we considered yesterday is ill-conditioned. So you can see the two lines. It keeps flickering all the time. So the two lines are indistinguishable, so you don't know where the exact. Of course, you can solve it algebraically and get the solution. If you want graphical method, if you want to solve it by using graphical method, this is the problem. Though you may do this algebraically and get the correct solution, this means that very small changes in the coefficients will lead to large oscillations in the results, right? So the round off errors become very critical. This means if you have a large system, if you are solving a partial nonlinear partial differential equation and convert it into a finite difference approximation, and you have a system of linear equations to solve, if the coefficients are such that the system is ill conditioned, then the round off errors become very, very critical. That is why we ask all our students to use what is called double precision and so on, right? What is double precision? So we instead of 8 decimal places, we ask them to use 16 decimal places and so on, okay. So these are all very critical, right. So this gives you an example of a simple two variable system which is ill conditioned, okay. All right. So system of linear equations, now we are considering several variables. So the general representation can also be written as correct. So this is the general representation. So I told you the examples for such systems are legion. I mean there are many examples which are available: fluid flow, chemical reactors, conduction heat transfer, okay. It is also used in data analysis and so on, electrical engineering. There are many examples where you have to solve a system of linear equations, okay. So now what is this Gauss-Seidel method? Of course, we saw in matrix inversion we write like this. I have to reiterate again that it becomes messy beyond a certain number of components, and sometimes a matrix is very difficult to invert and so on. So the Gauss-Seidel method is an iterative method. The matrix inversion is one shot, I mean you will, there is no need for iteration. You invert the matrix, you will automatically get x1 to xn. The Gauss-Seidel method, you have to start with some values of x1 to xn and then see how these progress, and so you have to apply your criterion of xi plus 1 minus xi divided by xi modulus into 100 is less than something like that. You have to look at all the components, you put a norm, and you have to look at the propagation of this error and how this error reduces and whether it reaches an acceptable value and so on. So the Gauss-Seidel method, an iterative technique, so So, we will start with guess values for all the variables. Lot of people take guess all the guess values to be either 0 or 1. There will be something which is non-zero which will start driving the system. Okay, if you can take 0, there will be some value, non-zero value that will start driving the system. Then you have to see how this converge. So what is the algorithm itself? Divided by A, good. Ah, I'm making a mistake. By good A22, likewise dot 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 xn an1 x1, what will be the last entry?
An
correct, an n minus 1. Divided by A. Needless to say, the system method will cup if AIA is equal to 0. So that is suicide. Why do you rearrange the system such that AIA is equal to 0? Now, when you are given a system of equations, it is important for you to rearrange the system of equations such that the AII is the highest. Are you able to get what I am saying? Okay. This equation should be used to solve for, no, simultaneous equations are there. I am just taking one example. This equation should be used to solve for, please be confident, for z, because you divide by 6, you divide by the highest possible number so that the errors do not grow. Okay, and you can rearrange the order of the equation, there is no problem. You can rearrange the variables and all that, right? These algebraic manipulations you can do. So, what you have to do is, you start with guess values for all the variables. You substitute the guess values of all the variables and determine x1. Watch very carefully. You determine x1, go to x2. When you get x2, for all other values except x1, you will use the initial guess values, whereas for x1 itself, you will use the latest or the updated iterate. When you go to x3, you will use all the old variables except x1 and x2, which will be the updated variable. Therefore, there is a dynamic updating of the variables in the Gauss-Seidel method. It is perfectly okay for you to start with these guess variables and do not dynamically update and get all the values and then do it. That is called the Jacobi iteration. Okay. So, Gauss-Seidel, so basically the key point is dynamic updating. Why would somebody want to use Jacobi iteration? So first Jacobi figured out, then Gauss-Seidel they argued him and they came up with something which is superior compared to that. Okay, first you wanted to keep things simple, so you figured out the Jacobi method, then you have something which has got accelerated convergence. Okay, what should be the stopping criteria? Is the algorithm clear? So for the classroom environment, two variables is too trivial. So we will have four variables is difficult. So we will restrict our attention to three variable problems, whether it is the classroom or the quiz, right. So three is the optimum. Okay, what about stopping criterion? Notation.
X k of ith iteration.
I. Is that okay? Where it is the case iteration? R square less than some epsilon predefined, right? (10⁻³, 10⁻⁴), whatever. Okay. So this is only the stopping criterion, but we do not know whether it has converged, right. You can converge, I mean whether it, when I say whether it has converged to the accurate solution and so on, right. So there are some additional criteria which have to be satisfied. So convergence criterion. This is from a numerical point of view, okay. From a funda point of view, what is it that guarantees convergence in a Gauss-Seidel system? Stopping criterion is numerical, it is left to you, left to us. We can put it in various ways, and okay, I can also say that xik plus 1 minus xik divided by xik modulus should be less than epsilon. This epsilon should be the same for all the variables, and but what is the convergence criterion is a, we are talking about a deeper funda. I mean, will all system converge? Before upfront, before starting the iterations, you have an idea of whether the system will converge or not. Not be singular, but for that you have to get the determinant, then you might as well. Not singular is okay. Modulus? So you already learned linear algebra. How many of you have learned linear algebra? Yeah, so it will be familiar to you. It has to satisfy the property called the diagonal dominance, okay. Diagonal dominance. This is a very crude representation of diagonal dominance, okay. Diagonal dominance does not mean that this equation, okay, this equation can be used to solve for z. Diagonal dominance means that this coefficient 6 must be greater than the sum of all the coefficients of other variables in modulus, okay. Mathematically we can show, that this is indeed the thing, but again this is not a numerical methods course, it is available in most books, right. So the diagonal dominance is like this, Aii modulus must be greater than sigma aij I is equal to 1 to n. J equal to 1 to n. J not equal to? Correct. Right. J equal to. So you can rearrange the equations such that diagonal dominance is satisfied. This diagonal dominance condition is satisfied. That is, if you have an equation 2x plus. Suppose I gave this equation as 3y plus 2x plus 6z or what, or 6z plus 2x plus 3y, you can rearrange such that you push this equation to the third one, so that it, this equation is actually used for solving, solving for z. Okay. Now there is a deeper mathematical funda. Diagonal dominance is a sufficient condition but it is not a necessary condition. The absence of diagonal dominance does not mean that the system will not converge. There are many systems which are not diagonally dominant but may converge. However, if diagonal dominance is there, convergence is assured. Okay, so it is not a necessary and sufficient condition. It is a sufficient condition, not necessary. Fortunately, most engineering systems are diagonally dominant. Okay, so we need not have to agonize about this point more. Okay, we'll just close it by saying most engineering systems are diagonally dominant. Sure. For all I. Okay. Right. Methods to control convergence. See, once these are satisfied, you may ask me, sir, why do you want to control convergence? I want to accelerate, always accelerate convergence. Not necessarily. Many times, if you try to accelerate convergence, it will diverge. Particularly CFD systems and all that, because nonlinear equation. What is a nonlinear equation? An equation which has a term u dou u by dou x. Okay. So the derivative is multiplied by not x or y. The derivative is multiplied by the variable which you want to determine. That is a nonlinear equation. Radiation epsilon sigma t to the power of 4 is a highly nonlinear equation. Radiation itself is very nonlinear because of t to the power of 4. Some people loosely try to linearize it by having a radiative heat transfer coefficient. You were taught this? What is called a radiative heat transfer coefficient? You learned this? What is it? What is radiative transfer coefficient?
Is that in d cube, d cube?
No, no. What you do is basically epsilon sigma t to the power of 4 minus t infinity to the power of 4, you write it as t square minus t infinity square into t square plus t infinity square. The t square minus t infinity square is rewritten as t minus t infinity into t plus t infinity. The t plus t infinity and the t square plus t infinity square are together combined to make it as 4 t infinity cube. Therefore, it becomes 4 epsilon sigma t infinity cube into t minus t infinity. When you have something multiplied by t minus t infinity, what precedes the t minus t infinity, prefixes the t minus t infinity, can be called as equivalent heat transfer coefficient, so that you can have a convective heat transfer coefficient HC, and this you can call it as a radiative heat transfer coefficient HR. It is possible for you to combine HC plus HR, but this can be very fatal in many problems. But for a starter, it is all right. I mean, somebody does not know anything about radiation, you can go ahead and use 4 epsilon sigma I can show in my conduction radiation course, I will show many examples in which this will fail, or I will just forewarn the students under what conditions these have to be used and so on, okay. But this is a simple linearized. So linearization is required if people want to get a quick solution to the problem. So these nonlinear systems, we have to sometimes slow down the convergence in order to get a solution to the problem. So what we can now do is, so if x is what you are seeking, x nu is equal to, you heard about convergence, I mean relaxation factors. Yes, anybody heard about relaxation factors? Do you want to write like this, or x equal to 1? I am going through an iteration, at the end of the 5th iteration I have got a value of x, at the end of 5th iteration I have got a value of x, at the end of the 4th iteration, okay. It is possible to use straight away the new value and put omega, sorry, okay, it is possible for you to put omega equal to 1. That means you do not care about the old value, you have so much faith in the new iterate, I want to use 100% of the new iterate, go ahead, do it. That is called a fully relaxed, it is called a fully relaxed numerical scheme, okay. Suppose omega is 0.5, that means you are using 50%, you are giving 50% weight to the new iterate and 50% weight to the old iterate, so you are under relaxing. Why you want to do that? Already I struggled so hard to reach, I am proceeding with iterations, why sir you want me to do under relaxation? Sometimes there will be lot of oscillations, you want to dampen out the oscillation, the system is going haywire, therefore you deliberately slow down the system so that convergence is guaranteed, okay. So that is called under relaxation. It is possible for you to have omega greater than 1, you can give omega equal to 2, that means you are giving too much weightage to the present iterate, that is called over relaxation, or SOR, successive over relaxation. Okay, so omega equal to 0, fully relaxed, 1, nah? Okay, sorry, omega equal to 0 is you have to go home, there is nothing there, right. So omega less than 1, what did I say? Under relaxation. Okay, whether to choose under relaxation or over relaxation or fully relaxed scheme, what is the value of omega I have to choose? I am solving an electrical engineering problem, I am solving the Helmholtz equation as an electrical engineer, or as a mechanical engineering I am solving the fluid dynamics CFD equations, or I want to solve the Penness bio heat transfer equation, I want to model cancer, I want to solve some bio heat transfer equation, cancer in the breast or cancer in the eye or cancer in the liver or whatever. What is the value of omega? Sorry, nobody will tell you what is the value of omega. You have to experience, you have to suffer, and then by experience you will, through the hard route you will realize that there are certain values of omega which will work, there are certain values of omega which will not work. They are very specific to a problem, and it has to be, that value has to be determined only by experience, bad experience more importantly than good experience. Of course, since we have all gone through all that and we have seen many students work, when some students come to us, we will say for the momentum equation under relax, for the energy equation over relax. So we can give some general guidelines, because under relaxation will slow down the convergence, right. Under relaxation means it will take a long time, but what is the point in quickly diverging and saying that, some mathematical overflow, or it gives some arbit answers, right. So sometimes we take longer number of iterations, we take more number of iterations, all right. But if you do under relaxation, it will converge. Sometimes we terribly under relax. So turbulent flows, we may have to under relax, we use relaxation factors of 0.2 and 0.3 and so on. That means 80% I use the old value, correct? And only 20% I use the new value. Okay, now let us solve some problems or solve a problem. Let the algorithm remain. Where do you encounter this in thermal systems, energy systems? For example, one example where linear systems are. Suppose you have got two streams which are entering a reactor vessel, okay. So this has a flow rate of Q1 and a concentration of C1, this has a flow rate of C2 and a concentration of C2, Q2 and concentration of C2, and I am specifying it is Q3 equal to Q1 plus Q2, okay. From an information, from the point of view of an information flow diagram, should I specify C3? If I specify Q3 equal to Q1 plus Q2, the fate of C3 is sealed, okay. So I can put our chemical engineering profs will call it as a stirred tank, okay, they will call it as a stirred tank. Some chemical, some petrochemical, something is there, okay. Now the key point in chemical engineering is in all these stirred tanks and so on is from this tank this output will go to some other tank, that from the, for that tank some third tank output will come. They are trying to mix and try to get some appropriate mixtures, they are always obsessed with mixtures, okay. Conservation of mass is critical in chemical engineering, conservation of mass with appropriate concentration with appropriate flow rate. They mix and match so many things, chemical engineers, also chemists, right. And these are all linear systems, Q1. So you will say Q1 into C1 plus Q2 into C2 is equal to Q3 into C3, correct. And then under steady state Q3 is equal to Q1 plus Q2, like that. If you have multiple reactors and the input of 2 or 3 are becoming, the output of 1 or 2 of this reactor is going to the third reactor, the output of the third is going to the fourth and fifth and so on, you can come up with a system of equations and you solve for the concentration of the various reactors. Apart from getting the concentration, because we have declared that Q3 is equal to Q1 plus Q2, it is under steady state, this C3 which is coming out will also be the concentration of the chemicals within the reactor itself. So this is an additional information we are getting consequent upon the fact that it is steady state and it is well mixed, okay. So with this background we will try to solve the problem. People who came early would have seen me desperately trying to do something before coming to the class. I was trying to set up some problem which is realistic. Let me see, I hope this works, okay. Problem number 13, 14, what is it? Problem number 13, the mass balance for 3 chemicals X, Y and Z. In a chemical reactor is governed by the following equations. So minus 6x x, y, z are in appropriate units. X, y, z are in appropriate units. X, y, z are in appropriate units. Solve the system of equations using the Gauss-Seidel method. Solve the system of equations using the Gauss-Seidel method. To determine x, y, z. Determine x, y, z. You are allowed to rearrange the equations. Rearrange the equations if required. You can take it down. Rearrange the equations if required. Do you expect convergence for this problem? You can write down all this. You can put it in telegraphic language. A, rearrange equations. A, B, is convergence guaranteed? C, initial guess x, y, z equal to 1, x equal to y equal to z equal to 1. Okay, I will take attendance. In the meantime, proceed. So, we should draw a tabular column, write the algorithm first. I have ensured that you do not have to rearrange, right? Okay. I could have twisted that, but it is okay. Right. Algorithm. Everything has become minus. Okay. Is it okay? Does it satisfy diagonal dominance? Yes, sure. No? Who says no? You are free to say no, but say why. It does not depend on minus or plus. If somebody has that silly doubt, it is modulus. Huh? So the convergence for this problem is guaranteed. If you so please, you can use omega, which is not 1, okay, if you want. I cannot put xi because I am going to update on the same table, correct? So it is difficult for me. Error is that r squared, with the understanding that r squared is sigma of xi plus 1 minus xi whole square plus 0 is 1, 1, 1. So using these values of y and z, you will get the latest value of x. From this value of x, you will get y. Using x and y and old value, you will get z. Then you have to proceed like that. okay. I'll just quickly discuss this truck problem, just a minute. I don't know whether all of you finished this, examining the stability of the operating points of the, okay. So you got a load curve like this, okay. This is the engine, okay. So this was B, this was A. Suppose you try to raise the engine, you try to increase the speed beyond this. When you increase the speed beyond this, what happens is, the load keeps increasing, therefore it brings the engine back to its, it brings the engine back to the speed. So this will be a stable operating point, but I guess if you accelerate here, what happens is the engine has got more torque, but the load is less, therefore it should move to this. But numerically, did we get this? This was what Abhishek was telling me the other day, but numerically, are we getting this? This is the physical stability of the system. The numerical stability of the successive substitution, I do not know. So physically, this is what will happen, okay. So when a truck is climbing uphill, what is the competition between the engine torque and the torque demanded by the load? Yeah. So what do you get here? 0.116. Yeah, 1/6, then 1.9, okay, error, okay, we'll, what is the error?
1.6,
okay, next one,
1.3,
2.0. 2.0. Yeah. Why is this fellow going so slowly? Third one. Good. 0.6. Then. 1.2. 1. Okay. What will be the error here? What is the error, Vikram? Hmm?
0.47.
Iteration 4. You can just work for 3 more minutes and then we'll disperse. 3-4 minutes. I think you have the 10 o'clock class. It's 9:48. Point? So it's not good enough. What, Sureka, what is the problem? Next one. 0.167. Very slow. 0.. So only converging, I think you will get it in the 5th iteration. No? What are you getting? 0.84, okay, then. But it is not unstable, right?
No.
It is converging slowly. 0.84, then 1.0. Okay, why don't you use omega of 1.8 or something? Why don't you update the value? Use omega 1.8, accelerate the convergence. Where is it heading? Point? How did you get the correct answer? Okay. What is the correct answer? X equal to? 1, na? Can we call 1? Okay, 1. Why?
1.87.
2.4425. Now let's see. Minus 6. Minus 6 plus 7.6. Is it okay? 1.6. It's not kind of, it's not all right. 1. Yeah, what is Z? 2.4 minus 6. This is what? 7.6, right? 1.6 plus 2.4. All right, fine, good. 4. So I didn't click to the 4 here. Okay, 2x. 2 minus 10.4. 11.4. Minus 9.4 plus 7.
That is 7.2.
Yeah, you got some slight error here.
Slight error.
That's okay. Here, 4, 5.9. This is too much.
200.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, more or less. So, let's stick to the other one. 0.98. This was 1. Okay, so this will be the mass balance. From the mass balance, you get this x, y, z. You can see that it's a lot simpler compared to the Newton-Raphson method for two unknowns. Okay, but if it is not diagonally dominant, it can be extremely painful, or it can go very slowly. It can go very sluggishly, just like you remember x to the power of 8 minus 1. We try to solve it using a Newton-Raphson method, right? Okay, so 0.00. We'll stop here.